Good afternoon. We'll go ahead and convene the October 15th Finance Committee meeting. As soon as I turn off my sound and my computer. What do we have on the agenda today? And if you want to introduce yourselves.
Chair Dominguez, Joshua Hagmark, Water Resources Manager, here with Brad Rare, our wastewater collection superintendent. And we're here to talk about a small component of a much larger issue, which is the sewer lateral inspection program. As you may note, this summer we came to council, but we've also been to Water Commission several times, and we're working on updating this program, which has grown dramatically over the last few years due to the fact that we keep finding more and more defective laterals in the system. And so today's discussion is primarily about trying to offer our customers more options to control costs. And so with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Rare to talk a little bit about what we proposed here.
So good afternoon. So I'm here today to talk about the sewer lateral inspection program, predominantly the sewer tap replacement element of it. And so to start out, I'm going to give a background on the program itself and the sewer laterals within the city. Briefly talk about the history of sewer lateral connection replacements over the years. Also discuss the repair process and kind of review that, and ultimately get to the proposed fees that we're here today to seek your recommendation on. So to give you a background, there's approximately 24,700 laterals within our city's GIS, totaling what we believe is around 300 miles of pipeline. That would equate to roughly 24,700 connections to the city sewer, and the sewer lateral connects the building's sanitary sewer to the city's sewer system. Our municipal code outlines the responsibility of ownership and maintenance, and the homeowner within the city of Santa Barbara is responsible for the entire lateral all the way down to and including the connection to the city main. And so the graphic on the right hand side indicates and is now part of our outreach to our property owners, showing the house connection all the way down to what we commonly refer to is the Y. So to briefly review the history of how private lateral connections have been replaced throughout the years, dating back years and years ago, we used to allow private plumbers to make the connections to the city main. However, that needed to change because of quite a bit of poor quality of the work. Our staff started to discover structural and operational issues, such as offset joints and things that precluded us from properly cleaning the sewer system. And so it's that interface between the private and the public that forced our hand, and basically city staff took over making those connections to the public system. So for a number of years, we had city staff who replaced that connection by basically taking out the old connection and cutting in a new, what we call a factory Y fitting. And that improved the quality of the work. However, it also resulted in workload issues, because now not only are we doing cleaning, but we're also doing construction activities. And so that continued through to about the beginning of 2013. And in 2013, we went out to bid in order to seek contractor support to do that work. And the way that works is a contractor would come in and do the scheduled Y replacement. The fee for that work would be passed along to the property owner through the permit fees. So it was one fee in addition to several other fees that happened during that time. And we've continued with that model since, like I said, about 2013. And there are annual increases to those permit fees every year. So the price started a little lower and then ultimately went up to where it was before we went out to bid this year. And it was a very limited scope of work. So it was kind of the process I'm going to talk about in a little bit, but they were only there to replace the Y connection. And it took a lot of scheduling. So that brings us to summer 2019. And based on all the feedback we've been receiving from the public on the costs associated with replacing the connection, we went out to bid and sought prices for additional services. And so we opened bids in July of 2019 in order to still maintain the quality of work, but also get better competitive prices for our property owners. And I think one of the important things to note here is, as you see at the bottom of the slide, despite the changes to the to how the work was being completed, it's always been the responsibility of this connection has always been the property owners, and it has not changed throughout this time frame. And so to quickly review kind of the slip process, every slip case in the city of Santa Barbara starts with a when we notify a property owner that they may have a problem, it starts with a letter, and we request that they inspect their sewer lateral from their building down to the main, or from the main up to the building, depending on where their cleanouts are located. And once they do that, they submit that video to us. We take a look at that video submittal, and we identify what repairs need to be made in order to bring that lateral up to compliance, or up to an acceptable standard. And so on the left-hand side, you'll see kind of an example of one of our what our letters look like. And this is a repair notification letter. And typically, we'll break out whether or not there's any lateral repairs, and in a separate line, a connection. If the connection needs to be replaced, it's a separate line on that letter. And so once that property owner gets that letter, they have, and we've adjusted this recently, 120 days to make the repairs. And there's a little asterisk there, because I want to state that when we know property owners are really working on this, and we understand that it's a complex procedure, we just ask that they notify us if they're having a hard time making that 120 days, and we're happy to give them an extension in order to seek more options or to get quotes from different plumbing outfits. And so once they've received their letter and they understand their scope of work, and they might talk to some contractors, it's time for them to now make a decision on what their repair solution is. And so I have down here option 1, 2, and 3. They're not specifically linked to the options that I'm going to discuss here as far as the fees, but we do believe everybody generally has a couple different options as far as their repairs. And so we want them to evaluate their options and ultimately seek out what the best price and best scope of work is going to be for them. So when it pertains to this, the lateral connection, or the replacing the defective connection with a new factory Y, this slide kind of indicates the current practice. And so one of the options that's on the table is they can continue with our existing practice, which would be have a local plumbing contractor open up a excavation in the city right away, or over an easement where that connection is to the city main, pay for all the permits and fees associated with the work that they need to do. And one of those permit fees is to have the factory Y replaced. That would be our city contractor jumps in the pit at a scheduled time, makes the replacement like what is shown here in the picture, cuts out that section, and then basically vacates the pit for the private property owner's contractor to finish out all the other repairs that might be on that lateral, or reconnect the lateral to the city main. After that, they'll go ahead and restore the pavement, and then that will pretty much complete the lateral connection replacement task. So based on the feedback we received from stakeholders and many people in the public, and from our own staff, looking at what the costs have been, kind of we've been informed about the costs, and also where we think we could standardize the work, we proposed a new option, which was that same contractor that's just hopping in a pit that's already prepared by another plumber, which can be more complicated to explain and to coordinate. Why not go out to bid and seek a bid from a city's Class A contractor to do the work? And so that's the second option, where we now have the option under the contract that we went out to bid for, have the city's contractor open up the pit, do all the excavation and preparation of that pit, and do the Y replacement for that property owner, all for basically one kind of fixed cost. That fixed cost is limited in some ways, because we had to structure it to kind of capture the majority of the lateral connections in the city. And so the limitation is up to 8 feet deep and about 4 feet 4 feet long trench width. So the fee that you're going to see in a second is really to encompass that. And we feel like that captures probably the majority of the lateral connections within the city. However, when some of the lateral connections are deeper, we also ask for an additive bid item of if they have to go in increments of 4 feet depth, please give us the cost for that. And so that's that additional $600 per 4 foot depth. So for example, a lateral that's 11 feet, a lateral connection that's 11 feet deep would be the fee plus an additional $600 to excavate down an additional 4 feet. That's at least what the proposed option is.
So this provides a few different benefits. One, it provides a baseline. So when customers are going out and shopping for cost, if they want to do it themselves, they have a starting point with their contractors to say, well, I know I can give the city to do this. Can you beat this? So that was one of the intents here, is to at least provide some certainty. With this price, it's kind of an all-in price. Assuming your pipe falls within the depths there, it's a known price. Some customers get in there and all of a sudden there's roots or something else in the way, and their contractor's like, oh, that's an extra. This is kind of baked into the cake, and to that extent, they're protected from potential change orders on these things. So we hope that this will be something that will help at least control the cost. And if successful, we are looking to expand this to other services, including inspection and cleaning of the lateral, mm-hmm. which is also a service I think we can potentially bid out and at least offer to our customers.
Before you go, go back. So I think the other kind of the other thing that this would change for us too is in the proposed kind of workflow. You know, the way we kind of expect this to happen would be property owner comes in, signs an agreement, pays the fee based on the information we have at that time. And pretty much it's a one-stop shop. They wouldn't have to spend as much time dealing with a plumber or multiple contractors. They would, by electing for this option, they would also be getting kind of city project management to help manage their lateral connection replacement, which is something we've heard from the public has been very complicated, and to try and understand all the things they need to do. So we also are proposing a third option on the table as well. This would be the sewer lateral connection rehabilitation option. And just so that we're clear on kind of what we're talking about, there are several different devices out there now these days that can actually accomplish what we're doing by excavation fully trenchlessly. The majority of the cost of lateral connection replacement is in the excavation, the backfill, the restoration of the pavement, all those things. And so if there's a way that we can do that without having to excavate, that could really be a cost saver for our community. So one of the options that we're looking at and that we're proposing here is to do what we call a lateral seal, or there's a name out there called Top Hat. And so the pictures in front of you kind of show how these are installed and what they look like after the lateral connection is sealed. There is a caveat, though, here, because this type of replacement is really only good for the pipe after it's been rehabilitated already. So after the sewer main has been rehabilitated, this type of device could go in and seal that lateral connection. That would be the ideal in order to not prevent future maintenance issues for the city sewer system. And so the fee that we're proposing for this, really covers the cost of the installation of this device, as well as the city project management to get this installed. But it applies to laterals located on the current or near-term sewer main rehabilitation capital improvement projects. And so as we start scheduling out future projects and we notify property owners as we're gearing up to rehabilitate our sewer main, that's the time that we could reach out to them and let them know about this option, and if they're interested in it, pay a fee and basically get on the list, and we'll help execute that lateral seal at the time that we have a specialized contractor coming into town to do that. Because unfortunately, we don't have any contractors locally that can do this work. And so here is our table of proposed fees. So to go over option one, again, that's kind of our status quo or our existing process. For a 4 or 6 inch lateral connection to a 6 or 8 inch main, that's like the 90% of our system. The fee for that would be $895. Or if they're connecting to a 10 inch or greater main, we're proposing $995, because it takes more coordination and additional work for staff to potentially handle the sewer flows that are going through as they're replacing that that connection. For option two, the more all-inclusive option that we're proposing, for a 6 and 8 inch main with a 4 or 6 inch lateral connection, that would be a flat $5,000 for that up to 8 feet deep, 4 foot long trench, or $5,500 for the 10 inch and greater. However, you can see on there, if the connections are greater than 8 feet deep, that's going to be an additional $600 per 4 foot depth of trench, assuming that there aren't any special circumstances that require engineering calculations to properly excavate that. And then that third option, the sewer lateral connection rehabilitation option, for 4 or 6 inch laterals connecting to a 6 or 8 inch sewer main, typically it's going to be lined beforehand, is $1,500. And that is pretty much the cost that we get annually from our capital improvement contractors. And so we're looking that fee would basically cover the cost of their work, and the city would be helping with the project management under the wastewater. The current wastewater fund
kind of assumes the contractor is coming up to do multiple. They're not going to come up and do one for that price, sure.
Yeah. So, and then the last fee, this happens sometimes where we have two sewer lateral connections that are very near each other, within the same trench. One can sometimes not be replaced without touching the other. And so over the course of the last 5 years, as we've been managing multiple contracts, this comes up, and so we thought it would be prudent to get a price from the contractors that we're bidding, and offer a fee for having the adjacent Y connection replaced, and that fee we're proposing is $450 per connection, regardless of what size of the main. And where this could really help, like for example, if two property owners' laterals are within that 4 foot trench, and one was planning on it, one maybe didn't have the funds to do it at that time, this $450 additional cost, all the other costs is going to be in the excavation. And so you could one property owner could pay the $5,000, one property owner could pay the $4,500, and then they could settle out amongst themselves how to make it fair for both of them to not have to spend $5,000 digging up basically the exact same spot. And so we offer this for that kind of situation. So I know I reviewed kind of the fees and kind of the processes quickly, but our recommendation today is that Finance Committee recommend the proposed fees to the full City Council for consideration. And following up on this meeting, we'll be at Water Commission on Thursday discussing this with them, and then City Council next week.
Thank you, Mr. Dominguez. Apologies, I walked in late, so I'm sorry if I missed when you covered this. But for option two, the $5,000 and $5,500, can you guys tell me a little bit more about how you came to that number? Did you solicit bids from local contractors and make that determination? Can you just tell me about how you got to that number, please?
So in listening to our public and listening to kind of our construction management team, we figured out what can we standardize. And so we figured that if we can standardize the repair that's within the roadway or in an easement and kind of bracket it to something, we could go out to bid. And so in June and July 2019, we went out to bid, opened the bids up to anybody who is a general Class A contractor to propose on that. And we received three bids for that, for the overall contract. And the prices came in slightly under $5,000 for that line item for the awarded bidder. The additional costs that are associated with that option two, I didn't go through all the little steps that go in, but one of the things that's necessary for that, for option two versus option one, is when a property owner has a plumber go out and locate their connection, that's something that is kind of built into that plumber's cost. For purposes of simplifying this for our contracting community, we didn't put that on our general A contractor to go do. And so city staff are going to be the ones that go out and locate that connection in the roadway to make sure that the contractor's digging in the right spot. So what goes into that $5,000 is not only is it just the cost of the contractor to do the replacement, it's also city staff's time to coordinate that work and ultimately schedule it and follow up afterwards with a photo of the lateral connection being replaced so that the property owner has some evidence of what they repaired. So it's an all-inclusive kind of one cost. It also helps with utility coordination when, for example, we're working very close to a gas line or a gas service. We want to make sure that the general A contractor takes all precautions. And so that allows us for our staff to have the inspector there ready to take care of it. And so it's kind of all baked into that $5,000 or $5,500.
Thanks. Kind of along the same lines, I just want to be sure I'm clear on the costs for one and two. With option one, there's the $5,000 cost of that you would have to connect the Y that the city's contractor would ultimately pay. And then there's a permit fee of or a fee of $895. So to me, maybe I'm not understanding, but no matter what, it seems like that option one would be a minimum $5,000 plus $895. So that's what I'm trying to understand that.
Those are really good questions, because this is what's so difficult about explaining this. So option one versus option two, the option one really, the pit already has to be exposed for option one. So the private plumbing contractor does all the work ready that Y for replacement. So they excavate down to it. We don't allow them to touch our city sewer main, and in order to replace the connection, they would have to do that. And so they generally go and expose everything, get it prepared, get the shoring in, and then call in our city contractor to do that work. That $895 is the fee that goes to basically covers the cost of our city contractor to hop in that pit. So this is in excess of whatever else the property owner is paying to their private plumber. For option two, there would not be a private plumber involved. The private plumber would be the one probably inspecting the sewer lateral for them to get them to the repair process. But at that time, if a property owner sees that on the repair notice that they only need to replace the lateral connection, they may elect to go with option two. And at that time, there's no more involvement from a city plumber. It would be, or a private plumber, it would be contracting with us to basically have that lateral connection replaced at either a $5,000 or $5,500 fee, as long as it falls within the bracket scope.
We can talk a little bit about the warranty with this. The warranty that the property owner gets, again, this is private infrastructure. The warranty is with the contractor that the city has contracted with.
Yes. Yeah, so when we put together a contract, we have a lot of terms and a lot of, we have insurance that our contractor is supposed to supply before doing any kind of work. And so we feel that there's a quality control mechanism built in. And part of that is that warranty. So our contractor, when they enter into contract with us, we get a 1-year warranty on that Y replacement. And that would be transferred to that property owner. Essentially, we would be taking care of replacing that through the contract mechanism we have if that Y were to fail within a year.
So can you, excuse me, can you please send us a copy of the PowerPoint just so we have it for records? And then I have a question about the background in the agenda report in terms of what triggers the property owner to have to go through this process. So you list several things, and I'm curious if you're not in one of those categories, then would this never be triggered?
So the main ways to have a sewer lateral inspection program case initiated would be, one, there's a private sewer lateral spill where we respond to the property and are aware of a problem on the private lateral. Second, if we are through our normal CCTV operations, we go out and we observe that there's a defect within the sewer lateral. Or three, a building permit initiated case. So 400 square feet addition to a property or two or more fixtures, plumbing fixtures are added onto a property, that would trigger it through the building side. Any one of those coming as you work your way through the process could require the lateral connection to be replaced. It's not always required. It depends on what the situation triggers this. Once you get down that road of being required to replace your connection, these are your options. These options are also available to people who are coming in and doing voluntary work. So sometimes we get property owners that say, I know I have problems on my sewer lateral. I'm constantly calling a plumber to root out my lateral. Well, when they get down that road, even though they're not being mandated by the city, when they get down that and come in to pull a permit for lateral connection replacement, these options would also be available for them as well too. So you can't replace your lateral connection without going through and getting it permitted. And so therefore these would also be available for them.
And so this is separate but related to the whole lateral process where people are on a more regular schedule and have to have the cameras. That's on a regular cycle?
So our regular cycle right now is on our commercial and industrial properties.
Okay, so not for a residential?
Not for residential, no.
So people who are getting letters, it's either because it's triggered by the 400 square feet of redevelopment or chronic problems, or the city's identified it through their testing of a main?
Yes.
Okay, so there's not a routine calendar where everyone eventually is going to get hit. There actually has to be one of these triggers.
Yes. The triggers that are in the report and that I outlined are what have been adopted and we've been using for the last several years. I think one of the things that has accelerated this or brought this to light has been how much work we've been doing CCTVing the sewer system and the sewer mains and looking at the data that we've gotten through that and showing how many defects are on sewer laterals.
Okay. And so the excavation, if the applicant chooses to do the excavation themselves, they need to use a general Class A contractor?
Not a general Class A contractor for if they go with option one. They have to have an appropriately licensed contractor. So that's generally a C-34 or C-36 contractor. And that has to do with where those contractors are allowed to dig and excavate. They could use a Class A contractor. We just typically see more of our plumbing contractors in the C-34 or C-36.
Okay, thank you. Is there more to the presentation or are there any more questions? If not, we'll open it up for public comment. Public comment. Krista Pleiser.
Good afternoon. I'm Krista Pleiser, the Government Affairs Director for the Santa Barbara Association of Realtors, and we are one of the stakeholders that Mr. Rear was talking about, and we have been working with Public Works on this, and we are very happy to see this proposal come forward in the standpoints of having more options for cost control and or to control costs is so important for homeowners. And when they get that letter that says, hey, we looked up your sewer lateral and guess what? Now you need to get it replaced. And oh, by the way, with the Y, you now need to pay in the excess of $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, depending on what the project is. It's a huge hit for people who are not expecting this. So in order to have programs like this and options give a lot more to these homeowners, and it does help them be able to control those costs somewhat. So we highly encourage you to move forward with this program, and also in which Mr. Rear was talking about previously is expanding this to include the sewer lateral itself also and have more options overall for this very expensive but much needed program. Thank you.
Thank you for being here to comment today, and thank you to the association for staying engaged and participating in such a meaningful way. So I don't see any other public comment, so we'll close public comment, and it's now to the committee.
I'll move the staff recommendation.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. Thank you for the presentation. We're moving on to the second agenda item.
Just give me a minute to load up here.
Take your time.
Mr. Smario, do you have another copy of that? Oh.
Mark, is that it? Okay, I'm ready when you are.
Please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. My name is Bob Samario, the Finance Director, and I'm going to present to you the preliminary year-end results for fiscal year ending 2019. And this is the year that ended June 30, and we are into fiscal year 20, so we'll be focusing on last year. My outline is as follows. What does preliminary mean? Looking back at reserves from last year, and then giving you some high level results for expenditures and revenues. You may recall we had a presentation just a couple weeks ago on the interim financial statements for fourth quarter, so you got a really a good sense of that. This is kind of trying to bring it all together and then look at what that all meant for means for reserves. And then we have a couple of recommended budget adjustments that I'll get to at the end. So what does preliminary mean? So we presented the fourth quarter numbers. Once that is completed, the process is completed, we really begin to close the books in preparation for the annual financial report. We call our CAFR, Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, and the audit related to that. So our numbers are pretty final, except that we still have the auditors who are completing their work. They may change or theoretically subject to change. I don't anticipate them to change, but we're still calling them preliminary. If they do change, they'll probably change only slightly. So for all practical purposes, I think we can kind of look at these as final numbers. And by the way, we'll be here in December to present to you the CAFR, and just didn't want to wait that long to kind of give you those numbers, those results. So I want to start with looking at last year's, when I say last year, fiscal year 2018, the reserves as of June 30, 18, because that's important in discussing what and give you some context to what happened in 19. So in 18, you may recall that we had a couple things going on. We had the brief low and Thomas fire and all that and the impacts and then other things. But at the end of the year, we ended up actually below policy by about $2.3 million. So we ended the year below policy reserves. And of course, that's our starting point. So I mentioned the impact of the debris flow and Thomas fire that specifically and particularly impacted our sales tax revenues and TLT or bed tax revenues. We really don't know to what extent, but we know with the Furia closure, we had there was significant impact. And then something else that actually happened, which is more of a timing thing. The old State Board of Equalization, they're called now the California Department of Fee and Tax Administration, they implemented a new system for processing the sales tax returns, and they ran into some problems with that. And as a result, they were very late in processing all the quarterly returns that businesses are required to submit, and in fact had to process a lot of those on a manual basis. So we never knew to the extent that that was an issue until really this summer after the year end. But we know now that we were underpaid in total from between sales taxes and Measure C sales tax by about $2.3 million in 2018. Those monies were received in 19, which is important in understanding why we might have had some good results in 19. But in 18, that was a significant hit and largely drove our falling under reserve policies in 18.
So is it a matter of they used the wrong formula, or it was just in a category that they didn't see and we weren't aware of, or a combination?
The 2.3 million, Mr. Chair, if you're referring to that, they were late in submitting, processing the application. So businesses have to, on a quarterly basis, turn in their sales tax returns and the money. They say if they send the money up to the state, but because they didn't have a chance to process them, they weren't able to allocate them out to the jurisdictions as appropriate, because part of that is determining where the money goes, because the money is allocated across in the county and of course the state. So it was just timing. They didn't get to it, and so they finally got to those returns on a more timely basis and were able to get those monies out, but it wasn't until 19.
So we knew at the time that it was happening. The cover sheet told us which months, and
we knew, but they didn't tell us the magnitude. Again, we found out in July or August what the magnitude was.
Okay, thank you.
I was really worried that we were just the Thomas fire and debris flow were really a big impact, but it turns out it was mostly this.
Great, thank you.
So in terms of the preliminary year-end results for the general fund expenditures, and again, we're focusing on the general fund here. This was a slide that was presented to you a couple weeks ago. I'm not going to go into detail with it other than to tell you that the number that was presented down at the bottom, $4.2 million, that's the variance between our budget and our actual expenditures. We think that's a pretty final number, and it is our amended budget, not adopted budget. So it's a pretty substantial savings. To the right of that, I think they might have mentioned that there are encumbrances outstanding, but in terms of how it affects our really bottom line and our reserves, that's not as important. But I also wanted to point out that we about a decade ago, we began budgeting the fact that we know we always have expenditure savings, primarily in salaries and benefits. We always have some level of vacancies. And because we didn't want to be too conservative with our budgeting, we thought it would be appropriate to budget some amount of money that we think is an estimate on average of what those savings might be in a given year. Historically, and it varies fairly widely, but historically, we typically see about $1.5 million to $2 million a year in savings from salaries and benefits, and of course, supplies and services to a smaller degree. So fiscal year 19 expenditure savings were pretty substantial, and it's because of vacancies we saw, particularly in departments like community development, library, parks and recreation, and police. Not really in fire because of minimum staffing requirements and overtime to fill that, but so pretty substantial savings. But we budgeted in 2019 about $2.5 million in what we call our anticipated year-end variance, based on what we thought we might end the year in savings. So we did better than that, but it really gives you some perspective that we didn't really save $4.5 million. It was about $2 million because we already planned on $2.5 million of those savings. What's interesting or maybe a little odd is that that year-end variance that we budgeted is not budgeted as an expenditure, but budgeted as a revenue, which we'll see in a moment. So it's just a revenue that's anticipated related to expenditures. It's a revenue that never gets realized, but it's something that we budget for to be conservative.
And Mr. Samario, so the encumbrance you're showing here is a little over $1 million. So these are items that we've bought or purchased and we owe that money, but we haven't been billed or had to pay out yet. So we're holding those $1 million aside.
Those are contractual obligations on our part, purchase orders, contracts that have not, where the services or the goods have not been received. So they don't constitute an expenditure of funds yet under accounting rules, but it is an obligation and we have to set aside reserves for those obligations.
And in general, how much in a fiscal year of that do we end up writing a check for later? Will we spend that entire $1 million? Okay.
Yeah. Unless there is some work that just stops for some reason, but generally speaking, we spend those outstanding amounts in the following fiscal year.
Okay. Thank you.
On the revenue side, you'll see that some substantial variances on the, in the first two rows, sales taxes, and then the Measure C sales tax. They're both sales taxes. The ones, you know, they're, of course, they're different. They're both at 1%, but you can see the material variances on both. And that kind of goes back to what I mentioned before, that of that total variance, which looks good in 19, really all most of that is because of the fact that we were underpaid in 18 and we got the numbers in 19. So the sum of those two numbers is like $3.1 million, if I'm doing the math right, maybe 3.2, but $2.3 million of that is really from last year, which sort of inflates that number. Other revenues, this is just to kind of give you a sense of some of the other things that were going on, but also to let you know that when you back out the anticipated year end variance, our other revenues really were under budget by 2.9, but again that $2.5 million relates to the expenditure savings side. So really the variance on the negative side is about $439,000 for other revenues. Again, you went through this before, but I want to just kind of try to help you bring it all together. And then fees and charges, these are really departmental charges and they vary. Community development, of course, planning and building, public works or engineering work order charges. But in this category of revenue, we actually came in well under budget. We were at $1.8 million below our estimates. A lot of reasons for that. On the public works side, $800,000 variance. Because it's based on engineering work that they do for city projects, when they have vacancies like they had in 19, then they don't have the man hours to do the work. There's a corresponding savings on the expenditure side that offsets that, but not 100%. In community development, we just saw some reduced fees in the planning side. And then to kind of bring it all together, sort of a general fund summary, you could see that, you know, when we presented this before, if we just look at the taxes as a category, which we did under one slide, it looks great. $3.3 million variance, positive variance, sounds great. But the fact that $2.3 million is really caused by last year's number and it's going to help to restore reserves from prior year only leaves a smaller portion of that. Other revenues were below, including the anticipated year-end variance and then fees and charges. So overall, not a great year in 19. Taxes did a bit about, again, about $1 million over budget, but overall, we were really below on the revenue side. So kind
I have
of
a question. If you can go back to slide 12. So you have the anticipated year-end variance right there above the bottom line. So 22 million was what we were expecting. And why are you adding those two together, the subtotal and the variance?
So this is to kind of give you a sense of what the other revenue category includes. So the other revenues in total on a budgetary basis, total $24.6 million, right? That number includes the budgeted anticipated year end variance. I separated it out because it's really an odd place to have that, because it represents what we expect to receive or generate in savings on the expenditure side. You'll never see a revenue in that line item, because it's just there. It's recognizing that we have this expenditure variance that we have every year, and that's just where we budget it. So we break it out. But in terms of what's really other revenue, it's the $22 million, and that's where you see a variance of 439. That's the true variance in terms of just the things that we expect to realize and are going to see revenues on. So it's just a way to kind of break out those two, because if I were just to show you one number for other revenues, it would be misleading. It would look like we did really poorly of 2.9 when really we knew we weren't going to see $2.5 million on the revenue side.
So this is more for budgeting purposes, for looking at the upcoming fiscal years than actually a cash flow, what we were expecting.
Are you, so which row or what are we talking about?
At having the variance here on this budget, including it here in this line item.
So again, the anticipated year end variance number is a number we budget. We budget as a revenue. Mm-hmm. We won't ever see those revenues, because it's just there for us to recognize that we will generate some savings on the expenditure side, and we estimated that to be $2.5 million. That's why I kind of say it's a little awkward that it's a revenue. And some people, we might, in some places you might show it as a contra expenditure budgeted amount. We just happen to show it as a revenue, but I wanted to highlight it because you're never going to see the revenue. It's going to look like a negative variance of 2.5, but it's not really. And that's why I break it out. The true number you want to look at is above that, the subtotal. If you're trying to get a sense of how our other revenues really did, we would back out the $2.5 million and look at what's left. And those are the revenues where we've shown on total a negative variance of about $400,000. I just wouldn't worry about the 2.5 being there as a negative number. It's just kind of how we account for things.
Okay, thank you.
So going to kind of bring it all together, and I'm going to use the term, and maybe in the future I might use this as well, but during the year when we bring to you the quarterly reports, interim reports, we are focusing on the horizontal. We're looking at budget for each of the for revenues and expenditures related to what the year-to-date numbers are for variances. So the focus really a lot is on the variance column. When we end the year, it's less important, at least to me, and in terms of how it impacts our reserves, of looking at this more kind of the final numbers and looking at it vertically. It's looking at the second row or column of numbers and to show, okay, what when now that everything is settled, the dust is settled, and the budget no longer matters, how did we really end the year? Because those two numbers, the difference between revenues and expenditures, is what's going to end drop to the bottom line regardless of our budget. So for 19, and these are essentially final numbers, we ended the year with about $157.3 million in revenues and $155.7 million of expenditures. So we actually ended the year with a surplus of 1.5. Make sense? What I did to the kind of the two columns to the right is I wanted this whole discussion of the $2.5 million. I wanted to put that in the right place to give you a sense of kind of how that affects. If you really want to look at it sort of horizontally on the variance basis, I've shifted that year end variance from a revenue to an expenditure where it belongs. So looking at operating revenues, we really ended the year, if you're going to compare to budget, about $1 million to the good. And on the operating expenditure side, we ended the year about $1.7 million to the good. So really tempering those two numbers. Remember, it was $4.2 million on the expenditure side before, but it's an inflated number. If you adjust for that year-end variance where it belongs, the variances aren't that great. But again, going back to the final results, we ended the year with a surplus. good news. Not a lot of surplus, but still good news. So what the reason I showed you at the very beginning what our reserves were at the end of 18, even though we're focusing on 19, is because that's our starting point for tracking how we're doing on reserves. So again, we started the year last year on July 1 of 18 with essentially in the hole. We were at a deficit of $2,266,000 in reserves relative to our policy requirements. We ended the year with a surplus of 1.6. And then we do some things at the end of the year to figure out how much money do we have available in available reserves versus restricted reserves. And this is, and I won't get into the details, but these are adjustments we kind of do in preparation for the audit. But because of those adjustments, we ended up generating more available reserves by the tune of $823,000. So on a net basis, we had an increase of $172,000 or a net balance of $172,000. So we kind of almost broke even with the combination of the 1.6 million year end results plus some adjustments. We completely offset that $2.2 million starting point. Make sense? Okay. Except there's just one final piece to this. And this has to do with how our reserve policies work. So this is a bit of a review, but just make sure everybody understands how our reserve policies work and what they're for. In our general fund, we have two buckets of reserves, one for disasters, as the name suggests, it's for natural disasters, tsunamis, earthquakes, floods, all those things, just like we had recently. But of a major significance, we've in since I've been here, we've never had to tap into that for a disaster, even though we've had a number of, quote, disasters. But it's set at 15% of the operating budget. So it's a percentage-based number. It's not a fixed dollar amount. And so it's always looking forward. So at the end of 19, we look at the 2020 adopted budget and we calculate 15% of that, and that becomes our disaster reserve. Our contingency reserve is calculated in the same way. It's just for a different purpose. It's more for economic contingencies on other uncertainties. When we had the major recession in 2008, the contingency reserve is what we went to help kind of provide a soft landing for the impacts. So that's the general fund policy reserves. And then for the way they're structured is because our budget grows every year, the only time I've seen it not grow is during the Great Recession of 2008 and 9, where we actually had to make cuts to the organization of $10 million or so. But every year it grows, and lately it's been growing by the tune of $4 to $5 million per year. So because that grows, so do our reserve requirements, because they're a percentage of that total. So on a combined basis, in simple terms, for every $1 million of growth, we have to set aside 25% just to stay even. The only way to do that is to generate surpluses at the end of the year. So if our budget grows by $4 million, then we need about $1 million in surplus in that previous year just to stay even. So for 2020, our budget grew by more than $4 million. It grew closer to $5 plus million, $5.5 million. So the increase in reserve requirements went up by 1.4. So even though we started in 18 with a negative, had a surplus, and we sort of broke even, we still have to meet the reserve requirements because they grow. So we didn't generate enough surplus at the end of 19 to cover the increase in reserve requirement of 1.4. So once again, in 19, we are sort of a little bit in the hole, not as bad as we were with 18, but we're still short of our reserve policies by $1.2 million. So that's kind of the status of our reserves. Let's see if there's anything else. So kind of the takeaways, we ended with a deficit in 18 because of the Thomas Fire debris flow, not sure to what extent, but certainly we had a significant underpayments in sales taxes that we got in 19, which meant that our sales tax numbers in 19 were artificially high due to those payments from 18. And even though we had significant expenditure savings, $2.5 million of that was already anticipated and budgeted. Over a two-year period, since we kind of had an unusual 18, over the two-year period we did okay. We just didn't do well enough to get back to a fully funded status in our reserves, but we made some progress. We cut it almost in half. Couple of adjustments that we're recommending in this is in the City Council's office. We entered an adjustment last time we were here, but we still need a little bit of a tweak by about $2,000. It's not going to impact reserves. We're just taking it from another department that has some surplus. And then in the fire department, we have some additional costs that we need to cover. We have some revenues to cover that. Fire is a tough department because we don't rarely see any savings, and typically we're running over. But unfortunately, a lot of that comes from mutual aid costs and revenues. So we're recommending an adjustment to both appropriations and revenues to balance that budget. But with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions on either these or the previous 15 or so slides. No questions.
The only question I have is, so what was the impact on the reserve from the Thomas Fire? Did the fact that our budget revenues decrease, did our actual reserve requirement drop, or is it based on the more optimistic numbers in the budget?
Mr. Chair, good question. So that the reserves are a function of expenditures, not revenues.
Okay.
And so, yeah, it's an expenditure-based reserve calculation.
And did our expenditures drop?
No. As I said, in 2020, they increased relative to our FY 2019 budget by about $5.5 million.
Okay. So the fact that our 2019 expenditures or the amended budget was 168 and we only actually spent 163 doesn't matter because the following year our budget, we're anticipating growth in expenditures.
Yeah, on a budgetary basis, the 163 reflects substantial savings we had in 19 in expenditures, part of which we budgeted. We don't expect in 2020 to see that kind of savings, but we always establish budgets based on a full complement of staff, and we try to anticipate what those savings might be on the revenue side from vacancies.
Okay, thank you. So appears to be no public comment, so open and close public comment. Do we have a recommendation from council, from our committee? Do you want us to take any action here?
No,
or?
No action. Just I hate to tell you this, but I'm going to make a similar presentation to the full council in about an hour or so.
Okay.
We thought it'd be good for everybody to know it. And so anyway.
Will we vote on budget adjustments at council?
Okay. I take that back. You could actually provide a recommendation to have council approve those recommended budget adjustments. That would be great.
So move.
I move that we
just move those.
Oh,
Mr. Friedman, move
sorry.
Those.
I didn't even hear you. I'll second that. Thank you.
Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Samario. With that, the Finance Committee is adjourned.